In this famous piece, for example, all the harmonies are sung either four or five notes apart from the basic melody line.
Gaudete, gaudete, Christus est natus, ex Maria Virgine, gaudete.
To our ears, accustomed to the subsequent 600 years of harmony, there's something missing, which makes the music sound bare and a little cold.
Tempus vadis gratiae, o producto amus, carmina letitiae, devote vedamus. Gaudete, gaudete, Christus est natus, ex Maria Virgine, gaudete.
What's missing is a combination of notes that, before 1400, composers had virtually ignored. The man who did use this note combination set things up for what was to be a giant leap for harmony. He was an English composer called John Dunstable. Dunstable introduced the mighty but imperfect third. Why is the third imperfect? If you count just three notes up from your starting point C, you arrive at E. Why isn't this third a perfect distance? The reason is that the third, unlike the fourth and the fifth, has two different versions, what we'd call now a major version and a minor version. It is Mr. Ambiguous. You can see just how ambiguous by counting further up the keyboard. If I count three notes from D, for example, I come to F, creating a minor third, ditto E to G. But F to A, like C to E, is a major third. The fact that the third can be either major or minor, depending on where you start counting from, might sound like only a slight technical difference, but it's not. The pivot between the major third and the minor third is the pivot upon which all Western music balances. Very broadly speaking, one is happy and one is sad, and harmonies using these thirds make the music richer, more subtle, and more affecting. But allowing the leans both ways third into music had one other big byproduct. Let's start with C again. We'll count up three steps and find ourselves at E, a major third. Then if we carry on up another three steps to G, we have created a minor third. But what happens if we play all of these three notes together? All these three notes played together are called a triad, and triads are the bread and butter of all Western music. Here's a song you may recognise, which is built on triads.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning.
15th century musicians discovered that triads had an important effect on each other when they were mixed together. It's to do with the constituent notes of the chords. The C major triad, for example, contains two of the same notes as the E minor triad and is therefore closely related to it. Similarly, the E minor triad shares two of its notes with the G major triad, and they are closely related. Mixing together chords that are closely related to each other creates a mood of harmonious smoothness, like melding adjacent colours in the spectrum. Triads have another great benefit. They can also create the sense of home in a piece of music.
Let me demonstrate with a famous spiritual song from a few hundred years later, Amazing Grace. In the first phrase of the song, we start on one chord under the words Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace.
Then we shift to another one on the word sweet. How sweet. Then home again to where we started. The sound. That safe landing, back to the chord we think of as home, is called a cadence or ending. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Everything feels right about that little journey of chords. We felt good returning to where we started at the end of the phrase. In the second phrase, we go on another short chord journey. That saved a wretch like me. And we have another little cadence by moving to a new chord on the word me. Again, this journey feels logical and satisfying. We're being led from one place to another. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. You can quite clearly hear that there's nothing haphazard about the choice of chords under the tune. It's meant to be. What's at work here is a logic in the chords. They're obeying strict laws, like the laws of gravity or the orbit of planets, whereby some chords exert more power and influence than others. Discovering the power of triads was like discovering a chemical reaction. Composers immediately sensed that something massive and transformative had happened. From now on, the basic chord, the triad, 1-3-5, was king. Just as the development of harmony up to this point had taken several centuries, so too the refining of musical instruments was a slow burn. But by the 16th century, a new breed of instruments had been invented, and they were to bring in a golden age of folk or popular music. In Tudor England, if you went to the barber's shop for a haircut or some form of crude walk-in surgery, while you were waiting, you could pull down one of these off the wall and have a sing-song. Yes, every self-respecting 16th century barber had a cittern hanging around for the use of his customers, many of whom would then accompany themselves while singing a jolly folk song.
Sing no more of dumps so dull and heavy.
I'm not making this up.
Was ever so since summer first was leavy. And sigh no more, but let them go, and be you blithe and bonny, converting all your sounds of woe into hey nonny nonny.
New instruments were changing the texture of music. Along with the cittern came the lute. Related to the lute was the stringed instrument known as the viol, and by the 1560s, the viol's young offspring, the violin, had been developed in Italy. The 16th century also saw rapid advancements in keyboard technology, so at home, if you had a few bob, you might have a virginal. But for sheer technological complexity, no instrument of the 16th century comes near to the organ.
Let them go and be you blithe and bonny, converting all your sounds of woe into hey nonny nonny. And sigh no more, but let them go and be you blithe and bonny, converting all your sounds of woe into hey nonny nonny.
Hand in hand with this expansion of purely instrumental music was a wealth of popular song. Often, the exact same tunes were used for both church music and secular music, with different words, of course. The first religious songs to get catchy tunes were the ones associated with Christmas. Some of the early carols were derived from jaunty folk dances. One reason these 500-year-old carols are still easy on the modern ear is because of a significant shift that was taking place in the musical structure at this time. It's to do with the positioning of the melody.
When in around 900 AD, chanting monks started to add extra voices to plain song melodies, beginning the process that became polyphony, the layering of many voices, it was always assumed that the principal tune, the red bricks in our diagram, was the bottom one, and the added tune was on top of it. Gradually, as two lines became three and then four, this principal melody got buried inside the four voices. That's why the third line down in any four-part piece of choral music got to be known as the tenor, because this was the part that held the main tune, tenere being the French verb to hold. We take it for granted that the tune of a piece of music sits on top of the texture, but this wasn't the case before the 16th century. Gradually, in all forms of music, the tune worked itself up to the top. Once the tune was sitting pretty on the top of the texture, you were more likely to be able to hear the words clearly, and the words were about to acquire a thrilling new significance. In 1450, in the German city of Mainz, one of the most important technological breakthroughs of our civilization was invented: Johannes Gutenberg's movable type printing press. Within 50 years or so of the arrival of Gutenberg's wondrous machine, music was being printed. Now, new musical ideas could spread further and faster than ever. It's shown in the career of the most influential composer of the period, Josquin des Prez. Josquin was born on what is now the Franco-Belgian border, but by his middle age, he was in Ferrara in Italy, working as a resident composer for a rich and powerful duke. In terms of pure sound, Josquin could not be described as a radical. But in one key respect, Josquin made a departure from what went before that was to become a hallmark of the music of the age.
Josquin is the first composer in history for whom the meaning of the words is paramount, and who tried to bring out and express that meaning in the way he set words to music. Small wonder that the majority of pieces he composed for the church were called motets, which means literally the words. One such motet is Miserere Mei, Have Mercy on Me.
Miserere Mei was composed in 1503. Josquin's employer, the Duke of Ferrara, was a friend of the most notorious preacher of the age, the Dominican friar Savonarola, a firebrand who constantly attacked the excesses of the Catholic Church. He was eventually arrested, and in prison he wrote a prayer asking God's forgiveness for falsely confessing to crimes under the agony of torture. The text of this prayer, essentially proclaiming his innocence, spread rapidly across Europe. So Josquin's task was to make this highly political statement completely clear. How he did so was new.
Quite simply, Josquin made sure that the words were always clearly audible. And that was revolutionary because up to then, believe it or not, the words in a piece of music were anything but audible. For centuries, song lyrics had been the poor relation. In folk music, audiences were as likely dancing, drinking themselves into oblivion, or having their hair cut as listening to the words. And in church, texts had been sung in Latin. What's more, they'd been sung in a way that made it virtually impossible to understand.
This is a technique called melisma, whereby long stretches of melody are attached to just one syllable of text.
The melismatic style could be musically attractive, but it destroyed any chance of the listener hearing what words were being sung. So in the first few bars of Josquin's motet, each voice utters the simple phrase, Miserere Mei Deus, have mercy on me, Lord, one by one.
Josquin
Josquin repeats those words, miserere mei Deus, throughout the piece like a mantra. He also finds ways of highlighting the words that were to be imitated by other composers time and time again. One is to have the voices cascade downwards like falling tears. Another is to stop all activity and have the voices sing together identical syllables of block chords. In 1517, only 17 years after Savonarola's execution, Martin Luther set in train the Reformation. Not only did religion change, religious music changed too. In Lutheran churches, for the first time, the congregation played a major role in music, taking the lion's share of the singing in their own language.
Luther, as well as being a theologian, scholar, writer, and preacher, was a composer. He fervently believed music should belong to everyone, not just priests and trained choirs. He wanted the congregations in his churches to be able to join in hymn singing with confidence and enthusiasm, and this meant having easy to pick up tunes to sing. Luther accordingly collected lots of popular folk songs of the time and gave them holy words. He also caused loads of new tunes to be written for the purpose. This is one Luther himself wrote, Eine feste Burg ist unser Gott, a mighty fortress is our God.
What's immediately noticeable about this chorale, or Protestant hymn, is that as it moves along, the words progress syllable by syllable, note by note, with a clear tune on top of the sound. This is what hymns were to sound like for the next 500 years. What followed the Reformation was more than 100 years of religious intolerance and state-sponsored terror. In the midst of this bloodbath, perhaps not surprisingly, the mood of sacred music was overwhelmingly one of penitence, remorse, and lamentation. But the dark cloud of agony and sorrow wasn't going to last forever. As the 16th century drew to a close, serious religious music, though it was still commissioned both by the church and by rich patrons, was about to lose its role as the dominant form of new music.
In the 1570s and 80s, a new wave of secular music swept up like a warm summer wind from Italy into the rest of Europe. It seemed to contain the seeds of something quite different from the angry certainties of the religious squabble. Not for the last time in musical history, art music, the music of posh people, was to be saved from itself by popular folk song traditions.
The pioneering figure in this new wave of secular music was a Franco-Flemish composer called Jacques Archedelt. The lute player in Caravaggio's picture here is playing some of his music. He was that famous. Everything about his songs cocked a snoop at pomposity and authority. His lyrics are concerned with human pleasures. They're full of sensuous imagery and sexual illusion. He worked for a while in Italy, where he wrote madrigals, then moved to France, where he wrote their equivalent, chansons. Typical of these is the cheeky, syncopated tale of Margot, the mysterious grape picker. The success of Archedelt's songs inspired many other composers, one of whom was a close contemporary of Shakespeare, John Dowland, who by 1600 had become the most celebrated singer-songwriter in Europe. Dowland's songs are strikingly different in tone and attitude to anything that had gone before. He's interested in people and their emotions, not gods and demons. A song like Flow My Tears doesn't seem out of place amongst those of our own time. Music by 1600 had become a rich mix of sacred and secular, instrumental and vocal, but almost anything you would hear at that time was on a relatively small scale. The time was ripe for someone somewhere to start creating long, substantial forms that would last a whole evening and leave audiences cheering for more, which is exactly what happened. Opera was born. The man of the moment, one of the 10 most influential composers of all time, was Claudio Monteverdi. In his hands, opera went from zero to hero. In opera, music is at the service of the drama, and so it needs to be able to express complex, even conflicting emotions. Luckily, Monteverdi had already spent years trying to do exactly that with his sophisticated, passion-filled madrigals. To do so, he had begun to recalibrate harmony.
Let's look at just one of his madrigals, which put cats among pigeons even in his own time. It's from the fifth book of madrigals of 1605, and it's called O Mirtillo, Mirtillo, Animi Mia. O Myrtle, Myrtle, my soul. Listen to this bit. Che chiami crudelissima amarilli. It's obvious Monteverdi is dipping in and out of all kinds of chords that don't seem comfortably related to each other. He wants you to feel surprised or intrigued, especially if it enhances the words of the poem. So on these words, che chiami crudelissima amarilli, the one you call cruelest amaryllis, he creates a series of deliberate clashes of chord called a dissonance or suspension.
Instead of sticking to chords that had close affinities with each other, he deliberately mixed up unrelated chords and exploited the strange, disorientating sounds this produced. It was music that could manipulate our emotions that Monteverdi brought into opera. He also introduced another ingredient, a dramatic oral effect that had been invented in Venice, then one of the world's richest and most powerful city-states. Its huge, cavernous basilica, St. Mark's, employed some of the best musicians in Europe, including, for a time, Monteverdi himself. On top of all this, the building served as a kind of musical and acoustical laboratory. An uncle and nephew team called Gabrielli had developed a kind of precursor of surround sound at St. Mark's, achieved by placing groups of singers and instrumentalists in different parts of the building and having them sing or play alternately. The technical term for the technique is polychoral, many choirs. Monteverdi knew and admired this polychoral style and thought it would work alongside his intimate, emotionally charged madrigal style when he came to writing opera.
Monteverdi didn't invent opera. A Florentine composer called Peri did in 1597. But Monteverdi did write the first good opera, Orfeo, which premiered in Mantua in 1607. He was aiming for maximum emotional effect, maximum narrative clarity, maximum impact, even shock, and wasn't going to obey anyone's rules about what he could or could not do.
What's more, Monteverdi invented a new combination of instruments never before gathered together. He borrowed old and new styles. He used choral music. He told the stories through characters directly expressing themselves to the audience. Almost everything about Orfeo was then a novelty. It was loud, it was long, and it was modern.
And let's not forget how liberating it all must have been, because as musical techniques have been developing century by century, so too had the ability to express more complex, subtle and unexpected emotions along the way. Monteverdi was using music plus.
Orfeo had been performed in a ducal court in front of a small, select audience. Monteverdi's last opera, The Coronation of Poppea, was performed in a Venetian theatre in front of a paying public. It's one of the most radical dramas of all time.
Why is Poppea so radical? To put it simply, because it was about real people and their complicated, messy emotions. The Emperor Nero and his mistress Poppea were actual historical figures, and Monteverdi's music acts as the soundtrack to their real-life passions. On the surface of it, Poppea is about lust and ambition conquering all. It ends with a duet for Nero and Poppea of unabashed eroticism called Pur te miro, pur ti godo, I gaze on you, I possess you. It appears as if Nero and Poppea are being congratulated for their criminal greed. The passion that oozes out of this duet, I adore you, I embrace you, I desire you, I enchain you, is so frank and sensual, it almost turns its audience, remember they're in the room too, into voyeurs, awkwardly witnessing the private interchange of two weirdly uninhibited strangers. This was new territory indeed, the full Monty.
The most daring part of this climax is what it meant to Monteverdi's fellow Venetians. They knew what happened next in real life, that is, after the fall of the curtain. Nero killed his new empress Poppea and their unborn child, and then himself, and his regime collapsed in flames.
Monteverdi's audience would have seen the opera's ending for what it was, a savage attack on Venice's arch-rival state, Rome. In the light of this, the coronation of Poppaea can be seen as a scathing critique of the excesses of Roman power and the pressing need for humane self-restraint.
Monteverdi paved the way for an explosion of musical energy. If innovations had come along at a snail's pace in the previous 1,000 years, the next 100 in music saw them coming thick and fast. In the next programme, the era of Vivaldi, Bach and Handel, and the exhilarating sound of invention.